He is captivating both on stage and screen, and I am so excited to welcome here, right on our stage, it's Andrew Rannells. What a human, Andrew!
What's happening?
And you look so handsome. Dressing the part, trying.
I can't believe we're in person.
I know. I came into the dressing room to talk to you.
You're a pioneer.
Thank you.
You're doing it. You're setting the example of how this can be done successfully.
And thank you.
It's very exciting to get to be a part of it. So thanks for including me.
You know what? It takes someone showing up to prove we can do it. So thank you, Andrew.
Well, I'll show up.
I'll show up for you.
I just live down the street.
I am such a huge fan of yours, and I got to see the original Book of Mormon.
Yeah.
And it was such a very special thing to have the privilege to be in the audience when you guys were launching that show.
That's very nice. It was a really exciting time, obviously. You know, it was, I had been on Broadway before, I had done a couple shows, but that was the first time I got to originate a part, and, you know, to have it be that show and get to work with those guys, like, and I think, you know, Josh and I, and the whole cast, I think, just felt a very unique ownership of that story, and we felt protective of it, and we felt that we wanted to, you know, protect it and tell it the best way possible. That's kind of, I mean, this is a clunky segue, but like, I gotta say, with like, I don't know, I'm sure you've had experiences like this, but like with the boys in the band that we got to do on Broadway and then like mm-hmm. making it into the film, I think there was a similar feeling that we all fell in love with each other and fell in love with the show and fell in love with these characters that we wanted to like, just make sure we did it right. Make sure that we, you know, because it's a revival, it is a film.
Well, it's a very important play.
It's a very important play. Yeah.
It was very groundbreaking. Was it 1968?
68, so it's a year before Stonewall.
Yep.
And it really was, I mean.
This was not a story being told.
No, and I think it, you know, there was not a lot of queer content at that time, so. I think that Mark Crowley, who wrote it, I think some gay people at the time felt like maybe he pulled back the curtain too far and showed too much of sort of what the inner life of these men were. And it was really, really satisfying and really beautiful to get to watch Mart see it 50 years later on Broadway and have an audience see it in a different way and not have to be the gay play. It's just a play.
You got to know someone quite well, right?
True. Are you talking about?
You had an on-stage romance.
It's called a showmance.
A showmance.
So it's when you fall in love during a show.
You met your man.
We met, and I felt like such a lazy actor that I fell in love with my co-star. I was like, this is so cliche.
Where else do you meet somebody when you're stuck?
Where do you meet people?
For 15 hours a day. That's why inner office romance, high school.
Yeah. Also, have you seen him? He's very attractive.
Yeah. By the way, he really
like,
is.
He's just like, what was I supposed to do? Not date him? But it was strange. Like the first time that we kissed, it was for work. So, like, that, it was like.
But you know, you were like, thank God for work today.
Totally.
Was it on the call sheet? And you were like, yes, today is the day.
But it was weird that I was like, oh, we're getting paid to do this.
I've definitely kissed co-stars and that I had crushes on.
Sure.
And you're really excited for that day
it's
of work.
It's a good day.
You're like, oh, we have that scene today.
Oh boy. I know, so many mints.
And the best part is, I've also had that moment where like, I'm just trying to like feel myself and I look over and someone's just looking so bored and over it. And I'm like, oh no.
Oh
this
God.
Is so weird. But one of the things that I love is the longevity of which it takes to find your stride in a profession that is very scary to kind of go for. You're going for a dream, but the reality leading up to finding that dream can be, you know, very sort of meandering and ungrounding.
Absolutely. And it's not linear.
Like
nothing is straight line. And I wrote a book last year called Too Much Is Not Enough that I really wrote for like young people to explain to them that like, oh, I wasn't hatched out of an egg for the Book of Mormon.
Yep.
Like I had a really rough path. Not rough, I mean, it wasn't that bad, but like, you know, but you have to be scrappy. Because I moved to New York when I was 19, and Book of Mormon, when I was cast in that when I was 31.
Yep.
That's a lot of time.
I love the way you talk about rejection. Rejection for me is related to a Filet-O-Fish. That's what my mom always got me whenever I failed an audition. And I still love them to this day.
That's hilarious.
It tastes like rejection.
Mine
and tartar sauce. Taco Bell.
Taco Bell. I remember going, the first time I was in LA, going to like having like a bunch of generals at Warner Brothers, and there's a Taco Bell like across the street.
I know it so well.
Okay, so I had all of these generals, which like are the grossest meetings, where you just chat with people and they all promise you jobs and then they never happen.
Yep.
So you just feel like you're, you know, I don't know. But I went to that Taco Bell and like ate my weight.
Yeah.
Burritos.
Yeah.
Because I was just like, I need something
to get me out of this. I still to this day think I comfort myself with like creamy carbs. Like it's all Filet-O-Fish related. Because all the things I turn to are like creamy pasta. And I'm like, yeah, that's sort of tartar sauce.
That's tartar saucy.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm like, oh, is it a carb and cream? Put it on me now.
Perfect.
It's like a weighted blanket of coping mechanism. And I'm still all for it.
That's fantastic.